ஆழ்வார் எம்பெருமானார் ஜீயர் திருவடிகளே சரணம் ஜீயர் திருவடிகளே சரணம். வி ஆர் என்ஜாயிங் தி சிம்பிள் மீனிங்ஸ் ஃபார் ஸ்ரீ பகவத்கீதா ஸ்லோகம்ஸ். எம்பெருமானார் ஸ்ரீ ராமானுஜர் ஹஸ் கிவன் பியூட்டிஃபுல் கீதா பாஷ்யம் காமெண்ட்ரி ஃபார் தி கீதா ஸ்லோகம்ஸ். வேதாந்தாச்சாரியர் ஹஸ் கிவன் detailed explanation for the same in his Tatparya Chandrikai commentary. Puttur Sri U.A. Krishnaswamy Iyengar has given an elaborate Tamil commentary with the help of these existing Purvacharya commentaries. He has also given simple word-by-word meanings for the Gita Shlokams. We are enjoying the meanings, simple meanings for Gita Shlokams based on this Tamil commentary. We are now looking into the 8th chapter. In the previous chapter, Emberman explained towards the end the aspects which are supposed to be known by the three types of adhikaris, such as Aishwaryarthi, one who desires for worldly wealth, Kaivalyarthi, one who desires for Kaivalya Moksham, enjoying the self, and Bhagavat Kaikaryarthi, one who desires for Bhagavat Kaikaryam. The terms which are supposed to be known by all these three adhikaris are listed out by Bhagavan in the end of 7th chapter. Brahmam, Karmam, Adidaivatam, Adiyajnam, Adibhutam are some of these terms. Bhagavan, in the beginning of 8th chapter, explains briefly the meanings for these terms, which we have already seen. And he also starts explaining about Antima Smriti, that is the thought process at the end of one's life in context of Bhagavan, how such Aishwaryarthi, Kaivalyarthi and Bhagavat Kaikaryarthi, all of these persons, individuals should think about Bhagavan in their last moments. Because in all of these, Karma Yogam, Jnana Yogam, Bhakti Yogam, Antima Smriti is very important. Depending on the final desire, one attains such birth in the next life. So this Antima Smriti is of great importance in Karma Yogam, Jnana Yogam and Bhakti Yogam. And that is what is being explained by Bhagavan in this 8th chapter. We have seen up to the 8th shlokam, where Bhagavan has given Arjuna some idea about how an Aishwaryarthi would think about Bhagavan at the last moments. We are continuing on with that same theme. In the 9th and 10th shlokam, Bhagavan explains how that Antima Smriti exactly happens and the result attained by one who has such Antima Smriti. Let us see the 9th and 10th shlokam. 9th shlokam first. Kavim Puranam Anushashitaram Anuraniyamsam Anusmaredhyah Sarvasya Dhataram Achintya Rupam Aditya Varanam Tamasah Parastad. In this shlokam, Bhagavan's greatness and his opulence is highlighted. Because this shlokam is focused on Aishwaryarthi and his Antima Smriti, Bhagavan is explaining his own opulence, his own greatness, which is what will be attained by someone who has performed karma yoga and who is remembering Bhagavan at the last moments. Because his goal, the Aishwaryarthi's goal, is to attain opulence, wealth in this world. Hence Bhagavan explains about such aspects. Kavim, omniscient, one who knows everything. Bhagavan is known as Sarvajnaha. He knows everything in all three times, past, present and future. So he is known as Kavim. Puranam, ancient. He is ancient. He has been there since time immemorial. There is no beginning for him. Anadi. That is explained here. Anushasitaram. He is the one who controls all the worlds. He is the controller of all of creation. Anoha Aniyamsam. Smaller than the minute Jivatma. Jivatma is atomic in nature. Anuswarupam. Very, very subtle in size. But Bhagavan even enters into Jivatma, resides in there as Paramatma and controls Sajivatma. So Bhagavan is subtler, even more sukshma than Jivatma. So he is called as Anoho. In Shastram Upanishad also it is said Anoraniyan Mahato Mahiyan. He is smaller than the smallest and he is greater than the greatest. Sarvasya Dhataram, creator of all. Achintya Rupam, having inconceivable distinguished form. Bhagavan's forms cannot be easily conceived by any of us. Aditya Varnam, shining brightly like the sun. He is very radiant, very luminous. Tamasaha Parastat, Paramapurusha, who is beyond the Mula Prakriti, primordial matter. Mula Prakriti is the base of all of Achit, matter. From Mula Prakriti, we see matter getting into various variegated states. Achit is generally highlighted and classified into 24 categories. The first level is Mula Prakriti, primordial matter, that is the basic initial stage. And then from there it transforms itself into Mahan, Ahankaram, then there is Manas, mind, then Karmendriyams, Jnanendriyams, Pancha Tanmatrais, Pancha Bhutams. So in this manner, the primordial matter transforms itself into 24 elements in Achit. Bhagavan is beyond this matter, this primordial matter. Anusmaret, one who meditates upon such Bhagavan. Then it is continued on the next shlokam. So one who meditates upon the Paramapurusha, who is omniscient, who is ancient, who is the controller of all the worlds, who is smaller than the minute Jivatma, who is the creator of all, who is having inconceivable distinguished form, who is shining brightly like the sun and who is beyond the Mula Prakriti. It's continued on in the next shlokam. Prayana Kale Manasachalena Bhaktya Yukto Yogabalena Chaiva Bhruvor Madhye Pranam Aveshya Samyaksa Tam Param Purusham Upaiti Divyam. Bhaktya Yuktaha with Bhakti Yoga Balena, with the strength of such Bhakti Yoga, Achalena Manasa, with the heart that is not chasing lowly pleasures, Prayana Kale, during the last moments, at the time of death, Bruvoho Madhye Pranam Aveshya, holding the vital life air, in between the eyebrows, Yaha, whosoever, Divyam Param Purusham, that divine Paramapurusha, Supreme Lord, Samyak Anusmaret, meditates upon well, Saha, he, Tam Eva, that Supreme Purusha only, attains. He attains such Supreme Purusha. That means, it implies that he attains the wealth that is similar to that of such Paramapurusha. Because this Aishwaryarthi's goal is wealth, worldly wealth, he will attain that wealth which is owned by Bhagavan with the help of his yogam, with the strength of that. When his heart is not chasing any lowly pleasures, if he is focused on Bhagavan during his last moments, so even one who is desirous of Aishwaryam, at the time of the yogam, performing the yogam, he should not be attached to such lowly pleasures. He should be fully focused on his yogam only. So such person who has such control, and he gets all of that strength by performing Ashtanga Yoga, through which he can control his mind, his intelligence, his desires, his indriyams, his senses, all of that can be controlled by this practice of Ashtanga Yoga. And by such practice, whosoever prays to Bhagavan with bhakti, at the time of death, if such individual can hold his vital life air in between his eyebrows, and if he can meditate upon divine supreme Bhagavan, then he will attain the desire which he longed for, which he always wanted to attain, which is Aishwaryam in this case. So that is 9th and 10th shlokam explaining the Aishwaryarthi and his result. From 11th till 13th shlokam, Bhagavan is explaining about Kaivalyarthi and his attitude at his final moments and the result he attains. Let us see them now. 11th shlokam, yadaksharam veda vido vadanti vishanti yad yatayo vitaragaha yad yad achi yad ichanto brahmacharyam charanti tatte padam sangrahena pravakshye. We have to understand that based on the words which are explained, which are used by Bhagavan, our acharyas take the context and give meanings. When the focus is on opulence, it is explained in context of Aishwaryarthi. When the focus is on giving up worldly pleasures only, then it is focused on Kaivalyarthi. When the focus is on Bhagavan and fully serving him, then it is for Bhagavad Kaikeyiarthi. So in these three shlokams, 11, 12 and 13, the focus is on giving up worldly pleasures totally and focusing on the Aksharapadam, which is the imperishable nature of Bhagavan. So here the imperishable enjoyment of Atmanubhavam, Kaivalyanubhavam is explained by the Acharyas. Let us see the word by word meaning for this 11th shlokam. Yat, that Aksharam, as Aksharam, imperishable, Vedavidaha, knowers of Vedam, Vadanti, say, what is said as the imperishable by the knowers of Vedam, Yat Ichantaha, that, desiring that, Vitaragaha, Yatayaha, without any desires for anything else, controlling their senses, Brahmacharyam Charanti, practicing Brahmacharya, celibacy, detachment, Yat Vishanti, attaining which, as a result of their practice, Tat Padam, that true nature of mine, which is to be worshipped, Te, for you, Sangrahena Pravakshye, will tell you briefly. Bhagavan is saying here, I will tell you briefly about the true nature of mine, which is to be worshipped, which is said by the knowers of Vedam as Aksharam, desiring which they practice Brahmacharya, without desires, controlling their senses and which they attain at the end of the practice as a result of their practice. So this Aksharapadam is Atmanubhavam as explained by knowers of Vedam, and this is attained by strict control of senses and brahmacharya. Even when there is little bit of attachment in worldly pleasures, enjoyment, especially sexual desires, there is very little scope for spiritual progress. So that is why brahmacharya is emphasized when it comes to either kaivalyarthi or bhagavad kaikaryarthi. Such persons should have very good control over their senses, and when such person control the senses, they will attain that Aksharapadam. Next, 12th shlokam. Sarvadvarani samyamya manohridi niruddhyacha murdni adhayatmanaha pranam astito yogadaranam. 13th shlokam also can be seen together. Omityekaksharam brahma vyaharan mam anusmaran yah prayati tyajan deham sayati paramam gatim. Let's see the word by word meanings. Sarvadvarani, all sense organs which are entrances to emit knowledge. The sense organs are the gateway for our knowledge gathering and ultimately sense enjoyment. Samyamya, restraining them to stop engaging in their activities. So eyes will desire to see, ears will desire to hear. One should stop engaging in the activities which the senses long for. Manaha, mind. Hridi, in me, who is the Akshara Purusha in the heart. Bhagavan is the imperishable Paramatma who is located in the heart. That is why he is known as Hridi. Mind. Niruddhya, engaging the mind in such Akshara Purusha. Yogadharanam, the state of fixed concentration. Full concentration should be there on Bhagavan. Mind should be fully focused on Bhagavan. Astitaha, having attained that state. Brahma, the word which indicates me, the Brahmam. Brahma is the word which indicates Bhagavan, and that word is Omiti Ekaksharam, is Pranavam. The word Om, Pranavam, is the word which indicates Bhagavan, Brahmam. The main syllable, that is the main syllable which indicates Bhagavan. Vyaharan, reciting that, chanting that. Mam, me, who is the meaning of that syllable? The word is Pranavam, and the meaning for Pranavam is Bhagavan himself. What is known from the word Pranavam is Bhagavan himself. Anusmaran, meditating upon. Atmanha, his pranam, vital air. Murdni, in his head. Adhaya, making it enter through the Sushumna nerve, Sushumna nadi. Deham, body. Tyajan yaha, one who gives up the body. Saha, he. Paramam, returnless, the land of no return. No need to return to samsaram, that is material realm, the bondage. Gatim, destination of self-realization, which is free from worldly matter. Yati, attains. So one who fully controls one's mind, focuses the mind fully into Bhagavan who is in the Hridayam, in the heart, one whose sense organs are all restrained, and having attained that state, if one keeps on reciting the Pranavam, and if he keeps on meditating upon the meaning of pranam, which is Bhagavan, such person, during the final moments, due to all his practice in this yoga, will be able to bring his vital life air into his head, the top portion. In previously for Aishwaryarthi, we saw that the vital air was brought up to the center of eyebrows, and from there he would release the vital air from there and attain his desirable worldly pleasure. Here for Kaivalyarthi, because it is moksham, Aishwaryarthi is still inside the material realm, in the material world. But Kaivalyarthi will be going outside the material world, and he will be eternally not returning. He will be eternally in that Kaivalyam state. He will not be returning to world again, in this material world again. So for that, in Shastram it is said that one's Atma should leave the body through the Brahma Kapalam, that is the space above the forehead, on the head. When one goes out of the body through the Sushumna Nadi, through the Brahma Kapalam, and reaches the Kaivalyam position, the Moksham, then there is no return for such person, says Shastram. So because Kaivalyam is Moksham, he will be taking that route only. This is why we see even in our Acharya's lives, in the Guru Parampara, Prabhavam and all, during the final moments, in the description, in the narrative there, in the narration, we will see that Acharyas will be, the Atma will be leaving through the Brahma Kapalam and ascending towards Paramapadam. So that same principle is applied here for Kaivalya Moksham also, because this is also land of no return. Kaivalya position is also, once reached, one will simply keep enjoying the Atma, and they will not have any other option, no other opportunity, because that is what they desired. So one will leave through the Brahma Kapalam and reach that eternal state of Kaivalyam, the returnless state, and will be free from material bondage forever. So that is explained in this, in these two shlokams. In the subsequent shlokams, we will see how Bhagavad Kaikariyarthi will have his Antima Smriti and what goal will he attain. Alvar Emberumana, G.R. Tirudi Gadesharanam, G.R. Tirudi Gadesharanam.
To learn such valuable information about our Sri Vaishnava Sampradaya, please download Koyil, K-O-Y-I-L app from Google Play Store or Apple App Store. Our website is koyil.org, K-O-Y-I-L.org.